So, that was a very wonderful presentation, and I have been listening to these tutorials and these slides I have seen earlier. But as Professor Lele was saying, that each author has a different way of putting his or her ideas, and the same could be seen here, that I could see some of the final points of the PPT which I had seen earlier, but I had not thought of them as I thought of them today. So that was the essence of the whole tutorial. But before I go ahead, my name is Prashant Shukla, and I'm a faculty in the Department of Mechanical Engineering, and we have two components that we have to take care of during this two orientation. One was of how to deal with tutorials, which you have just now had a look at, and the other is of handling labs, practical labs. So before I formally start, could you please tell me how many of you are handling tutorials? You can raise your hands. So those many students are handling tutorials. How many are handling labs? How many of you are not handling any of those? Is it because you have not been allotted? As, pardon? You have not been, no, I am saying either you are handling the tutorials or you are handling the labs. Is there some other duty also that you are performing? Pardon? Evaluating the answer sheets. So just the answer sheets and not being involved in the tutorials. So after the exams, you are given the solution and you are supposed to evaluate them. Okay, so we have a fair distribution amongst all of them. I will be basically focusing on handling labs, because that is also one of the prime duties that the TAs are supposed to perform. And before I start, there are certain questions that students face when they come to IIT BHU and they have to handle labs. And that is that they have to deal with students who have qualified JEE. Most of us have not come through the JEE system. One of you may have been a BTech student here or somewhere else, but most of us have not earned a degree through a JEE system. I think 95% of all of us would fall in that category. So once you enter into an arrangement with a group of students who in this society are supposed to have qualified the most difficult examination in the country, there is immediately a bias or a complex that is generated in the mind of the PhD student who happens to be a TA. Oh, I am handling BTech students. Would I be able to handle them? Am I as good as them? There are many questions that would be there, and if we are honest, I think you, most of you would be feeling this when you handle students who have gone through JEE. And on the other hand, I think they too would be having same expression or same idea about you, that I have qualified JEE, I am not very sure whether my TA has qualified JEE. So they too also would be suffering from this type of a bias or whatever it is. It may not be the best word that I could search for, but there is some type of a mental block on both sides. How to address that? Because unless your psychology is in a state where we can, where you can handle this question, this question will always be in your back of your mind whenever you are handling people whom you think are much smarter than you. The other problem that comes when you are handling TAs is the problem of language that I have felt. I don't have a PPT, so I'll not be going in a very structured way. I'll be mostly dwelling on my experience here in handling practical labs with TAs. So the other impediment is language. And there also you find that there is always some gap between the communication skills of our teachers and our tutors, because of various social reasons, about which some light was shed by Professor Lele, that many of us do not come from English-speaking background. So that itself creates in our society some sort of a complex. Some people call it inferiority complex. I don't know whether that is also the correct word, but there is some complex because of the language also, when we feel that we may not be very comfortable in dealing with our students. So I think these are the two major biases which a PhD scholar confronts when he or she goes to handle practical classes. Okay. So these are the two problems which PhD student or M.Tech student would face: this IIT stigma, non-IIT stigma, and non-English speaking stigma. So first of all, I think that one must get rid of these two stigmas as soon as possible, because they are not genuine stigmas. They are stigmas which have been generated in a society which has evolved in such a way that we feel that the IIT students are the best, and if you can speak and communicate in English, you are better than a person who is perhaps communicating the same thing in the vernacular language. So these stigmas have to be shorn off as soon as possible. And the best way to do this is not just by contemplating, but by our action. I will give you a particular example. Whenever you handle an experiment as a PhD student, invariably you know that the results that you would be getting from that experiment would not correspond to what is given in the textbook. An undergraduate student generally does not think that, because the way things have been going on, most of the time, most of the B.Tech students who come to the classes have not performed experiments in class 11 and 12 because of the coaching through which they are going. They are no longer doing experiments, they are just preparing for coaching, and therefore they feel that if a formula gives F is equal to MA and that experiment is conducted, I should get the exact value of the unknown variable because that is what the formula says. But as a research scholar, as a student who has gone training with an M.Tech also, you know that invariably you do not get that response, you do not get that answer, because any experiment that you conduct is filled with lot of discrepancies, lot of precautions have to be taken, there are lot of sources of error in an experiment. So there is the point where you can score over a B.Tech student. That is my personal experience. A student would tell you, sir, this is the answer in the book, I should be getting that. You should smile and say, okay, we'll see. And then you know in your heart of hearts that that is not the answer that you will be getting, because your experience has taught you that there are certain uncertainties, certain errors which are embedded into the experiment, which will never get you the exact result. And that you have gained through the insight, that you have gained through your 2 years of M.Tech or maybe 1 year of PhD. So that is the capital that should give you confidence while handling students or B.Tech students as your tutors during your B.Tech course. And for that, the only thing that can be done is that before you enter into a lab, you must work with those experiments beforehand. When we do experiments to our TAs, what we do in our department is that before the experiment formally starts, we hold a demonstration 1 week before actual experiment start. So we basically depute an experiment to a particular TA, a teacher is associated with that experiment, and then we go to the experiment, perform the experiment with the student, with the TA, and then we tell the student or the TA that these are the issues that have to be taken care of while conducting the experiments, and these are the results, and this is the theoretical result, and what are the reasons for the discrepancy between the obtained result and the theoretical result, and then you explain them the sources of error, what are the precautions that have to be taken in the experiment. So this is a knowledge which a B.Tech student or your student would not be having, which you have got, because you have been trained in that way and you have prepared a priori before the experiments about the outcome of the project, of the experiment. So one thing that you can do to gain confidence about the experiment is to handle the experiment before you actually handle it before your students. Do that experiment yourself, be confident on that experiment, so much so that even by looking at the readings, you should be able to identify why system is working incorrectly, what is the problem and how it is to be rectified. Once you are able to do this, your student, your BTech student will have a changed opinion about your capabilities. And that is what I have seen many times, because I know the student, I teach undergraduate students, I teach MTech and PhD students, and generally I find that there is a, sometimes to start with a very scornful attitude towards MTech and PhD students because of the reasons I told you earlier. But later I realized that once the PA is able to satisfy the questions and show to the students the intricacies of the experiment involved, and he can explain or she can explain what is the theory, what are the results, and why there is a mismatch between the theory and the experiment, and how about performing the experiment over and over again, by taking these final points, we can close the gap between the theory and the experimental results. The undergraduate students begin to gain, or they change their attitude towards the MTech and the PhD students, and they begin to realize that no, my degree is something else, my earlier qualification or my JE exploits are a different story, but here now it is a different ball game, and my TA has more to tell me than what I know. So the moment that happens, there is a change in the perception of the student about his or her TA. And for that you have to work hard. It doesn't come easily. You have to go before the experiment, perform it many times, and gain that level of expertise where you can answer the questions that the TA may be raising. So that is one thing which I think can only come by hard work. There is no substitute. If the experiment starts on a Monday and you think that if 10 minutes before the experiment you perform that experiment on a particular equipment for the first time and hope to win over the hearts of the BTech students, which initially have some grudge against certain people, it is impossible. You have to work hard, you have to learn those things, and then demonstrate your superiority as a TA to the students, and then they begin to respect you, then they begin to think that no, and also the horizon about science also changes. They begin to learn that what they teach, what is taught in the class and what is done as experiments, there is always some error. Because normally we, at the undergraduate level, we don't do error analysis of the experiment. But the moment we conduct experiments in the class, there is something called error analysis. And as researchers, you know that those working in the experimental field don't get papers published if their uncertainty of their experiment is explicitly mentioned in the papers. So those types of things are not used to because that is not part of their curriculum. But the moment you go into research, you know that publications are only possible because the peer review is happening, that you have to give the degree of uncertainty of your experiment so that the scientific community can get an idea about what is the error or what is the sound in your signal. So those types of things, when the student begins to see through your words, through your actions, the whole relations between your PhD student and the BTech students change. And I remember that the initial scorn goes away and they become bhaiyas. And then they speak to say, bhaiya, aisa kare to. Bhaiya, not in the typical sense where we use it, of the UP bhaiyas, no. With a sense of respect. With a sense of respect, they call you bhaiya. So that is a transformation that I have seen when you are able to demonstrate through your hard work your skills and what you have learned over the years. So that is one thing that I feel. And the second is the issue of language. Now you see that, as Professor Lena was also saying, that initially we didn't have many TAs. In fact, there were very few TAs because in the whole department there were 3 or 4 SRFs, and when the senior most SRF exhausted his or her time, then a new SRF would join. So in a major department like mechanical or metallurgy, there would be not more than 3 or 4 SRFs. Now in a department like mechanical engineering, we have 100 PhD students, roughly 100, I think 95 or something. So that is the size of student, number of students that we have got. And this is why, because now stipends are there, scholarships are there, funding have been more generous since we became an IIT, and also the intake of students has increased, UG students. I remember in 2002 when I first took a class of mechanical engineering, I think it was second year fluid mechanics, I had 53 or 54 students in my class. And by the time the semester finished, I remembered each of them by their name. Now there are about 170 students, and I stopped taking attendance because that consumed about 10 to 15 minutes just to take the attendance. So there is no point in taking the attendance. Imagine 40 lectures, 10 minutes for attendance, that means 400 minutes. 400 minutes means how many lectures gone just for taking the attendance. So now we have gone away with, I have at least gone away with the process of taking attendance. I circulate a sheet, hoping that all of them would be honest and they would sign their names. And, but no, as sir said, be generous but firm. Sometimes in the middle, I just call them by their names and check them. And then there is a rule that has been dictated in the first class that if you are found doing a proxy, you will miss that day's attendance and the next 2 days' attendance. So then they said that, sir, I didn't sign, somebody else signed on my behalf, what to do? I had said anyway and he knew that I have not come, so he signed in my name, so what do I do? So I was in a fix, what to do? So then I told him that this is my WhatsApp number, in case you are not coming to the class, before you the class starts, I should get your WhatsApp message that you are not coming to the class. So now in case that WhatsApp message doesn't reach me and your enemy signs in your name, so you will be responsible, not your enemy. So that has solved the problem, and now they know that sometimes if I have, usually you know teachers that sometimes they overstep the 15 minute time schedule, so after 45 I don't have anything to talk now, what to do. So I use that opportunity to, okay, now we will check whether the attendance is correct or not. So that saves me my 5 minutes of disgrace and does a good job, and we are able to find out who are the ones who have been using the proxy. So once the students know that these are the rules of the classroom, once or twice they do it, but then they stop. And usually after the last, in the last 3/4 quarters of the class, if you do that attendance recheck, you will find that everybody is present. So I was coming to the issue of number of PhD students. So that has increased a lot over the years. And now, ideally, not practically, ideally, M.Tech and PhD students are supposed to be involved in future primarily in academic and research work, primarily. Now you may go for some other type of job, that is a different issue. People do go, but normally it is expected that when so much of investment is being made on M.Tech and PhD students, they are supposed to be researchers and teachers. You'd be surprised, as I am, that once you complete your PhD and your postdoc, you appear for an interview and you are selected as an assistant professor. There is no formal training or test to check whether you can teach or not. So your publications are seen, whether you have published exhaustively or not, and a small, maybe 15, 20, 30 minutes presentation is now done, where all your teaching skills are checked. Now imagine that teaching constitutes maybe 50 to 60% even more of our time, and there is hardly any test done to ensure whether you can teach or not. Even as a research scholar, you are supposed to publish 2 SCI or Scopus papers to get your PhD degree. Nobody checks whether you can really deliver a lecture or not, or how good you are at the communication level. And suppose tomorrow you go to do a job in teaching, or even if you are working in a research lab, you have to make a presentation or some project that you have written. How can you communicate? How can you speak? That is always a big problem, especially for people who are coming from this part of the country. Most of them have been educated in, as one of our colleagues was saying, in some vernacular schools. So this is also a very good time as a PA to overcome that handicap. That is a very good time, because normally in our hostels we always speak in our vernacular language, maybe Hindi, or if somebody is from Bengal, in Bengali, whatever language. The only time when research scholars can converse in English is when they are taking tutorials, or maybe when they are interacting with their supervisors. So that time, 2 hours or 3 hours, when you are interacting with your students, that is the time when you can converse in English with the TAs. Initially there will be problems, but over a period of time you will feel that with each passing day, your grammar, your diction, your pronunciation, your confidence is increasing. And if you do it steadily and consistently, definitely by the end of the semester, you will find that you are better placed to speak in English. Not that I am pro-English or anti-English, but obviously, as you know, that beyond the point, you have to have a minimum, at least a threshold has to be overcome. As far as English goes, if you're able to, writing paper is also a problem, because most of the time I find that students are very good if you explain, sir, tumne kya kiya, sir, maine ye kiya, but if you tell them to write, then you realize the problem that it is very difficult for them to write. And most of the time, our research scholar is struggling to find the correct word or writing the paper correctly, and it has to go through multiple revisions. So if you have to overcome that problem of even correctly speaking English and correctly writing English, peership, tutorship offers you that opportunity where you can converse with the students in English, where you can talk to them, their questions will also come to you in English, and that is a time when you can gain confidence. So I think that is also a very good opportunity that the students get, the TAs get, to overcome their inhibition or as far as speaking in foreign language for them is concerned. So these are the two points I think that are very important when doing the experience, when handling them, as far as the handling the PhD students and that psyche is involved, and the second issue is the language. Once we have got over with these two issues, now coming to the technical issues of handling the experiments. Most of the time, I don't know about experiments in all the departments, but like in our department, which the experiments which I take care of, like in the fluid mechanics lab, so what we do is that we tell the students, our TAs, about the theory of the experiment, what are the results that are expected, what are the pitfalls, what are the do's and don'ts. I don't know whether all faculty members follow this or not, but at least we urge our TAs to come to us if there is a problem, and you also should go to your concerned faculty members if you are having problems in conducting any experiment, because we are dealing with the practical component here. So if you are doing an experiment and if you are having a problem, it is your right and it is your duty to go to the concerned faculty and tell that faculty that this is how the results that I am getting, can you please tell me what are the problems? Because once you do that, only then you will feel that the quality of experiments is improved and we will be able to actually better explain the experiments to the TAs. So being particular with the experiment is very important. Secondly, it also trains you how to handle different types of people. Initially, when we used to handle experiments way back 15, 16 years ago, there were 4, at most 5 students before an experiment. Now there are 8 to 9 students. They all surround the experimental setup and we don't know where to stand. It sometimes becomes very hard. I mean, we are just shoulder to shoulder with students, and this is a practical problem. Also, you will notice that there is a wide difference in the backgrounds of different students. There are students from North India, there are students from South India, there are students from underprivileged sections, more girl students are coming. So we are getting basically a wide cross-section of society as our students. How to handle such students itself requires shedding a lot of our inhibitions and biases about certain people. We may have biases because all of us are born with biases, but when there are 10 or 9 students standing in front of us from a very diverse background, how to handle those students so that they feel that they are given, all of them are being given equal importance, that also requires a lot of mental training. Because when we talk to people, our subconscious biases operate in our mind. We don't know about them, but the moment, the amount of eye contact that we are having with some students and no eye contact with other students is somehow an inbuilt bias that we may be having in our head. So all these things of communication skills, those we have to learn by addressing those students, and we must be show no partiality to any of the students. It must appear that they have come to a place of learning and that learning is being imparted to them irrespective of their social, economic, cultural or any other biases which they constitute of. So those things also have to be learned, and in a class one has to practice those things, because once you go out of Varanasi or go to some other place, you can't behave the way you behave in Varanasi. Don't take it otherwise, but I feel that a lot improvement is required in the way other people behave. If you go to some other place, you will find that their level of sophistication in India itself, if you go to abroad, then there is a vast change. I mean, you don't know what caste that person is, what religion that person is, to what nation that person belongs. You don't even know the sexual preference of that person. Yeah, because, I mean, that may be a taboo word here, but there it is not. So how you communicate with a person so that it is a very thorough professional democratic type of conversation where all these factors become extraneous and what you want to communicate becomes the center of focus. Those things also have to be learned while communicating with the student. So when you enter into a lab session, you must first try to address every student. First of all, try to tell the experiment that this is experiment about. So let us take a very simple example. I don't know whether it will be a generic example, but let us take a very simple example that, so this is a microphone, and if you give an impulse, you get an increase in the amplitude of the signal. So let us say it's a very simple electronic type of signal. So first of all, one must explain the basic principles that go into that experiment with the maximum rigor that is involved. Because there cannot be any looseness of anything. When you're explaining science, you have to be very rigorous, and each and every word should be loaded with meanings. And as Einstein said, things should be as simple as possible, but not simpler. So don't trivialize scientific theories and statements. Keep them, give them the due gravity that they command. Explain the theory, and then come to the practical part where you explain the different components of the experiment and what each experiment does. So if this is a signal generator, so this is a generating the signal, this is an amplifier, this is a power source, this is amplifying the signal, this is your receiver, this is your microphone. So all those components should be explained properly, and their interfacing should also be explained. So the components separately and components in unison, that must be explained to the students carefully. How the experiments have to be performed, you have to tell them carefully. You have also to tell them the do's and don'ts. Very often I see students, they are standing at the experiment like this. So if there is a table, a bench on which the experiment is kept, some of them would sit here, some of them would kneel on it, some of them would push it. Why? Because they have not been trained to conduct an experiment. Your work as a TA is to train future scientists. So they have never been told in the school, because now in class 11 and 12 they are busy doing their JE coachings rather than conducting experiments in the class. So when they come to the undergraduate level, you have to tell the sanctity about the sanctity of the experiment, of the setup, that it has to be handled with care, just as a child has to be handled with care. You can't just spoil a child. Similarly, the experiment has to be given due respect. You cannot kneel on it, you cannot just push it, you cannot just throw it away. You have to carefully handle it. So that has to be told to the student. Because if the student does not learn to respect the experiment, you forget everything. That is the beginning of arrogance of any person. So you have to teach them that how they have to handle the experiments, what discipline has to be maintained. In our class, as a rule, we do not allow students to come to the class if they are not wearing proper shoes. For the simple reason that we handle fluids, some fluid may fall on the foot of the student, some weight may fall on the foot of the student. So just as aprons are given to the students when they are doing their BTEC labs, you remember that when you see students wearing aprons because they are doing their fitting shops labs, so then some metal chip may fall, so they are supposed to wear aprons. Similarly, we have made a rule that we will not allow students to come to the class if they are not wearing proper footwear. They must learn that they are students in the lab and they cannot wear, and even with the TAs, initially I found that students, BTEC students are coming in full proper well-covered shoes and our TAs are coming in chappals. And one of the students looked at the TA and he looked at me and smiled. Meaning thereby, humko to aap pehron ke sir juta pehniye aur aapka TA jo hai khud chappal pehen ke aaya hai. So I could understand what the student meant. He was smart enough. So then we told our TAs that if you are a TA and if you want your student to follow certain guidelines, then you must also set the example. So now our peers are also following this, and gradually it has come. I mean, there was no coercion. They realized that if the discipline has to be followed, and gradually, initially discipline looks bad. But once you see everybody in that discipline mode, then it becomes part of your daily life. And now our peers are also following this. We don't allow our peers to come on time. We allow our students to come before time. Because if the experiment has to be conducted at 11 a.m., we cannot expect our TAs to come and switch on the experiment and start conducting the experiment 11, because every experiment has some warm time. No experiment can immediately start. Even an electronic circuit has to be given some time for it to stabilize, so that the thermal equilibrium is established and you get steady state readings. So we tell our TAs to be there before time. And we also should come before time, so that we set up the experiments before the actual experiment starts. And we were also having this problem. The TA used to come at 11. Sir, 11 baje ka to experiment hai, to sir main 1 minute pehle aa gaya hu. He said no, 11 baje ka experiment hai student ke liye, aapke liye nahi hai. Agar 11 baje ka student time hai aur main as a faculty member 11 baje aao, to main keh sakta hu tum mujhe kaun ho, to mujhe batane wale ki mujhe kitni bajana. You will tell me what time I have to come. That is not the way, that is arrogance. If the experiment starts at 11, I should come at 10:30. My TA should come at 10:40 and my student should come at 11. If I start coming at 11, I can't tell my TA or I can't tell the students to be there at 11. So just as charity begins at home, discipline also begins at home. And you as a TA should reach. And you will say, sir, who are you to sermonize? I am nobody to sermonize. But we are following it in our lab. And we are having good results. So that is why I'm basing it on some experiment and not on some high sounding principle, but we have seen that. So, and if the students come late, today also six students came late to class. I had a lab from 11 to 1. Five or six students came late, panting with sweat. Kya hoga? Sir, thodi der ho gayi. I thought अभी 2-3 मिनट है चलता है इंडिया में यू कैनॉट गो बाई अमेरिकन स्टैंडर्ड्स तो ठीक है क्या कभी बाहर खड़े हो जाओ 5 मिनट बाद में बुलाएंगे सो दैट अ सेंस गोज दैट दे हैव डन समथिंग रॉन्ग 2-3 मिनट हुआ इफ यू पनिश देम मोर व्हाट विल हैपन द डेमोंस्ट्रेशन हैज स्टार्टेड नाउ इफ यू टेल देम टू वेट फॉर 10 मिनट्स दे हैव लॉस्ट द डेमोंस्ट्रेशन सो अल्टीमेटली यू आर स्पॉइलिंग देयर टर्न तो 2-3 मिनट बाद बोला अच्छा जाओ बोले जाओ अपना एक्सपेरिमेंट करो कल से अगले बार से टाइम से आना हो गया सॉरी हो गया उसके बाद two students stand 15 minutes late. Now I was in a dilemma what to do. If I allow them, then ultimately this, you set the ball rolling and every time somebody will have a problem. You said, kabhi kuch ho gaya, kabhi kuch ho gaya. So politely I told them that we have an extra time. If there are 8 experiments in a semester, we keep one arrival time. So this is your arrival time now. Next time please come in time. And we had to send back. I didn't like it. But I have to do that because if I don't do this coming late to the class, this disease is very infectious. Yes, it is very infectious. And I told them, come, you will go to work in Narayan Murthy's office. Tab to tum 8 baje ho gaya, tum 7:55 par apna utha yahan pe. Wo aajkal ho hota hai wo. What do you call it? Biometric, sorry. अभी हम लोग जो हो हम लोग मेबी टुमारो वी आल्सो हैव इट एट सो दैट बायोमेट्रिक मींस यू विल पुट योर थंब एट 7:55 देन यू विल बी वेरी पर्टिकुलर बट सिंस इट इज अ स्कूल इट इज अ गवर्नमेंट ऑर्गेनाइजेशन सो यू कैन यू फील दैट यू कैन इवन कम एट 8:15 एंड नथिंग विल हैपन सो एक बार हुआ दो बार हुआ दैट मैसेज स्प्रेड लाइक वाई फायर एंड नाउ स्टूडेंट्स आर कमिंग इन टाइम वन आर टू मे बी देयर बट दैट इज ऑलवेज इट इफ इन अ क्लास ऑफ 170 वन आर टू कम लेट आई डोंट कंसिडर दैट टू बी अ जनरल ट्रेंड दैट इज जस्ट एन एक्सेप्शन एंड दैट कैन हैपन टू एवरीबडी बट वी हैव बीन एबल टू मेंटेन आवर डिसिप्लिन वी हैव फॉरबिडन द यूज ऑफ मोबाइल्स इन आवर लैब्स द फर्स्ट इंस्ट्रक्शन वी गिव इन आवर लैब्स व्हाट हैपन इट इज अ 2 आवर एक्सपेरिमेंट एक घंटे में एक्सपेरिमेंट कर लेते हैं एंड नाउ देयर आर 8 पीपल सो एक आदमी रीडिंग उठा रहा है उसमें से एक आदमी तेज होते हैं वो कैलकुलेशन करते हैं और बाकी व्हाट्सएप देखते हैं दैट इज हैपनिंग आई वाज टू सी एंड आई कुडंट नो एनीथिंग बिकॉज आई हैड नॉट टोल्ड देम अर्लियर सो दिस टाइम द फर्स्ट थिंग वी टोल्ड इन आवर लैब द फर्स्ट थिंग दैट वी टोल्ड देम इन आवर लैब्स इज दैट दीज आर द डूज एंड डोंट्स यू विल नॉट कैरी अ मोबाइल विद यू इफ यू हैव टू डू एनी कैलकुलेशंस यू विल ब्रिंग योर कैलकुलेटर्स विद यू No mobile is powerful as far as a calculator is concerned than a calculator. So you bring your calculators, no mobiles in your class. That is very difficult. In fact, you will be surprised that some of the experiments where electronic signals are there, removal of a mobile causes a change in the reading. And how we notice it, that we were doing an experiment on the wind tunnel, and I found that all of a sudden there was a sharp decrease, a sharp variation in the readings. I didn't know what is happening, what is wrong, the air is flowing at a constant velocity, how come the lift and drag is suddenly changing? I didn't know anything. What had happened is one of his students had kept the mobile in the vibrating mode in his pocket, and the phone started running, started ringing, and I didn't know that the phone was ringing, and there was a variation in the reading. I didn't know at that time. Then one day, I was moving next to that and my phone rang and I saw that the same fluctuation in the, there is a note cell. When the air is flowing over an aerofoil, like the, you have an aircraft, so to measure the lift and drag, there is a note cell. So basically it is a transducer. It is a pressure transducer where the motion of the load is converted into an electrical signal. So there, if there is an interference of an electronic signal, that can disturb the reading, and that was happening. So that was also scientifically, and as well as discipline wise, we do not allow students to bring mobiles to the classrooms or to their labs. And I think this, you should be also very be very careful, because that diverts them, and also that basically demeans the sanctity of the lab. A lab is not meant to do WhatsApp. A lab is meant to conduct experiment for the limited time that is allotted to it, and that they must learn, because we are here to teach them and make them disciplined. We very often say ki bahut indiscipline bad gaya student mein, bahut indiscipline log ho gaya. It is very easy to say, it is also the truth, but one of the reasons why indiscipline has grown is because indiscipline has grown in us also, as faculty members, as maybe you can say TAs. We don't put our best foot forward very often, and that has a trickle down effect, and then that goes down and that becomes a perpetual disease in the institute. So if you have some benchmarks in your lab about the discipline and about how you go about the work, so that is very important. So once you have demonstrated the experiment, let the students do it. You show the experiment once, how the reading have to be changed, how delicately some instruments have to be handled, because some of the experiments are done on very expensive equipments. So then you have to tell them how to handle the experiments, how to handle the equipments. You can demonstrate one reading to them, let them do the experiments themselves, and just have a close watch how they are conducting the experiments. And once they have conducted the experiments, then you can go and have the readings done. Normally what our practice is, experiment kara diya, reading aa gaya, acha, sign kar diya, now the students are happy and they go. I think that the story doesn't end there. If it is an experiment of 2 hours and the student has generated a table in the class, in the lab, after 1.5 hours, and some readings are coming erroneous, it is the duty of the TA to tell the students, what is the problem, this is the gray area, please try and do the experiment again. Half an hour mein experiment ho sakta hai, kyunki ek hi do reading leni hai. Please do that experiment again. And if the readings come correct, this will be a great booster for the student. His respect for you will increase. I could not do it. My TA has been able to tell me where the fallacy was, where the lacuna was, where the shortcoming was. And now, with his or her advice, I am able to perform that experiment correctly, and I am getting results which are close to the analytical results, or which are supposed to be the correct result. So you must also have an iterative process. Where if the readings are not correct, you are telling that the experiment mein gadbadi aisa hi aata, aisa nahi hai. Setup may have some problem, but there may also be some errors on in conducting the experiment. The protocol that has to be followed for doing the experiment may not have been religiously followed. So you can tell the student to do it again, and once the student do it again, they gain confidence, you gain respect, and ultimately their conviction in science and the infallibility of science increases. So that way it is a good learning process also. As you know that I consider TA's apprentice. It is like being an apprentice where before a job people are kept like an apprentice. So it is like an apprentice. Now apprenticeship may have a very demeaning or degrading word, so I'm not using it, but it is like an apprenticeship for a teaching or a research activity which you would be performing in future or you are performing. So that way your role is very important, and you have to basically teach the student and in the process learn the student, learn from the student. I remember, it is my personal experience, and I don't have that wide an area where I can comment on experience of others, nor do I have a very vast database of research, but the best way to understand any subject is to teach. And as a practice, after every 2-3 years, I take a new subject to teach. Because the subject in which I am not very confident, the best way to learn that subject is to teach. Because then you spend sleepless night because there is a deadline. 9 baje meri subah class hai aur mujhe ye padhana hai. So then you will open NPTEL lectures, you will run here, you will run there. Somehow you will manage to perform. That performance will not be very good initially, because teaching itself per se doesn't have some inbuilt quality. It is because you do it over and over again through multiple efforts that your second and third attempt in the same course would be much better. So if you have to teach a course, it is best that you, if you want to learn a course, it is better to teach a course. And similarly, if you want to learn some experiment, it is better to be a TA in that experiment. So suppose you are handling pen or cell or some other equipment, but if you become a TA, you will also be exposed to the problems that a student faces. And as Professor Bola said, I was just defining a problem itself is half the answer. If you can precisely define what is the problem, that itself is half the answer. So in a research paper, if you read the abstract, what does the abstract say? This has been attempted, these are the loopholes, this is what has been done. So you define the problem very precisely in the abstract, and rest of the paper is basically your presentation and your methodology and your results and discussion, everything. So if you are working with a TA in an experiment, they will ask very good questions, and that questions generates your data bank. And in fact, many of the problems which I have learned is through good questions that students have asked me. Because you don't, when you read it, sometimes you forget to ask those questions or read in between the lines. But there are some very smart students that they will ask such a smart question that you will say that no, I don't know. And one must have the humility and the humbleness to say no, I don't know, but I will read and tell you. And next time, yes, that should haunt you when you go back to hostel and you must try to find the answer either from your colleagues or from your faculty members, that this was the question, what can be the most probable answer or the most correct answer to that question. So that way one student learns many things. So I think that TA-ship to me is a very important tool or very important step in one's learning process, in one's upbringing in an education institution, from a place which is far away from IIT BHU to a place where to IIT BHU, to a footing as a launching pad or a step to even better and higher places of learning. So that is a role that TAs can play. Normally lagta hai TA duty lag gayi, 8 ghanta kaam karna padega, ye hai wo hai. Normally we don't take it in that stride, because TA duty ko million baar samjha jata hai. In fact, even if you have to check the questions, checking question itself is not a very easy thing. A problem ka solution to be broken into smaller parts or part marking karna require a lot of understanding and lot of skill. When you can break a problem into smaller parts and then you grade on the smaller parts, that itself requires a lot of skill and lot of basically skill of judgment as to how much marks should be given to a small part. And sometimes when you're checking the copies also, you come across very spectacular types of answers, where a solution which you were solving in 10 lines or 12 lines, by a simple technique, a student is able to give in 2 or 3 lines. And whenever, you won't believe, 2004 copies, 2005 copies, I don't know where the student is, I still have those solutions in my locker, in my elbow in the department. where they have solved the solution by a very novel technique, and even I was wondering, my God, I couldn't find it, I didn't know it, but he has been able to, and I made it a point to express it in the class that, see, this is a solution which has been solved in a very nice way, and I still have some of those solutions kept with me, so once in a while when I'm cleaning my room after 2-3 years, when it gets too dirty to be made any further dirtier, so when I'm cleaning my rooms, I come across those old paper when I cherish the memories of the students, 2004-2005, I don't know, there must be fathers having kids or mothers having kids, 2004, at least it is 15 years, so they must be at least 35 years old, but still I have very fond memories of the solution. So that way I feel personally that teaching or tutorship is a job where it can be the best job or it can be the worst job. So if you take it as a compulsion that I have exhausted all my options in life and therefore this is the teaching that I am doing, so that would be the best job. But as Professor Lela said, that even if that is the case, how to get the best out of it, that is the only option that is left behind you. And the more you work hard and the more you interact, I think it is one of the most satisfying jobs as a TA, where you can earn respect, you can earn knowledge, and you can even have value addition about yourself, your way of thinking, your way of speaking, your skills, your human interaction, and overall I think a great sense of satisfaction can prevail if you do your job properly. And this is what I had in my mind about some of the experiences that I had. They were not very well organized, maybe here and there there was some mismatch and overlap, but that was a general overview I could think of in such a short notice and before Professor Lele. So I was not very confident of even speaking, because I didn't want Professor Lele to be sitting here and listening to me, but he has been kind enough to give some time. So that is what I wanted to say. We have another few minutes. So any questions? I will be looking forward to answer them. Any practical questions, even if it is a very ugly question. कि सर बातें तो बहुत अच्छी है मगर हमारा जो फैकल्टी मेंबर है वो तो ऐसा करता है, अब बताइए हम क्या करें, अगर हम इम्प्लीमेंट करने आ जाए तो हमारा क्या होगा. इवन इफ इट इज दैट आई वुड लाइक टू आंसर इट इन द परमिसिबल ज़ोन दैट आई एम कंफर्टेबल विद. एनी क्वेश्चंस प्लीज क्वेश्चन डोंट कम मोस्टली इन टू सर्कमस्टांसेस आइदर यू हैव अंडरस्टूड एवरीथिंग और यू हैव अंडरस्टूड नथिंग. So, please don't fall in both of those categories. Any questions? Just for my satisfaction, I could have some questions. Mere liye puch lijiye, if that helps you. So that I'm happy that at least some questions were asked. Yes, somebody was raising the hand. Or was it an illusion? Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yes.
Pranam sir, this is Babita Karaji from University Studies Department. Sir, I'm a TA and I have allotted on creative practice duties.
Pardon, I could not follow. What TA in?
Creative practice.
Okay.
Sir, there are 3 hours time allotted for me. Sir, how can I manage these 3 hours time?
What is your nature of your tutorship?
So there is already a sitar class, sitar. Musical instrument, sitar.
Ha, sitar.
Yeah.
Ha.
So then what I do in these 3 hours?
No, I could not actually, honestly, you are a TA in HSS.
Yes, sir.
And you are supposed to handle sitar.
Sitar.
So, I mean, in sitar what? I mean, playing the sitar or maybe telling about the
note? Teaching
sitar. So do you know how to play sitar?
No, sir.
And is it part of the... No, there is nothing to laugh. Is it part of the curriculum?
No, sir, no. I am from geography background.
Pardon?
Geography. Yes.
No, my question is that how does HSS have teaching sitar as a course? I'm not, because if it was a school of music or some other place, I could have imagined.
See, it is not our course, but I had to take in class from another BTEC or Intech student that I don't know.
Now, please pardon me if I'm asking questions again and again. My only question is that HSS teaches courses in humanistic studies, sociology, economics, English, natural language processing. This is what I understand. Now, you are saying that you have to play sitar.
I have to take class.
And what?
As a TA, she has to be there in the class. Creative practice.
देखिए उसको let us frame the question properly. हम लोग अगर आप इसलिए comfortable हैं नहीं अगर language which we can understand the basic idea है ना creative practice है तो they consider playing sitar as one of the components of
yes sir musical instrument
and what are the other things that they do in the creative practice
dances form like Bharatanatyam
okay
and tabla है ऐसे
Pardon? Okay, please. I could understand you partly, ma'am, but could not fully understand.
मैं हिंदी नहीं बोलता
हूँ. हाँ, बोलिए बोलिए.
वो जो क्लास है, उसमें स्टूडेंट्स प्रैक्टिस करेंगे और हम लोग बस मतलब देखेंगे कि वो प्रैक्टिस कर रहे हैं कि नहीं. We are supposed to do that work only. So मेरा मेन मतलब उनका जो मेन कंसर्न ये है कि 3 घंटे वो मैनेज करना है. उसके साथ ही 2 और 4 घंटे ऑलरेडी हमें क्लास में जाने होते हैं. 8 घंटे वैसे ही हो गए प्लस 3 घंटे भी. उसके बाद अलग से हमें कुछ अटेंडेंस के कार्य और ये सारे काम करने होते हैं. तो इसमें एक है कि अगर हम डायरेक्टली अपने सुपरवाइजर को बोले तो कंफ्लिक्ट होगा हमारे और सुपरवाइजर के बीच में. तो हम उसे कैसे उस कंफ्लिक्ट को कैसे मैनेज करें आप कुछ ऐसा बताओ.
कॉन्फ्लिक्ट किस इशू पर? कॉन्फ्लिक्ट इस इशू पर है कि मुझे 8 घंटे से अधिक समय देना पड़ रहा है या कॉन्फ्लिक्ट इस इशू पर है कि मुझे सितार जैसे इंस्ट्रूमेंट को के बजाते समय बैठना पड़ रहा है जिस इंस्ट्रूमेंट के बारे में मुझे कुछ नहीं मालूम. कॉन्फ्लिक्ट क्या है? पहले तो कॉन्फ्लिक्ट क्लियर हो. व्हाट इज अ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट?
वो तो सर सितार तो अच्छा इंस्ट्रूमेंट है, वो अच्छा ही लगेगा, लेकिन ये कि टाइम ज्यादा.
So if you feel, I mean, I'm not sure that is, I don't think that this was her question. Her question was that sitar is played, she doesn't understand sitar, she has to sit there for 3 hours, what she should do? To that you have added that there is an additional problem that you have to work beyond 8 hours.
Yeah.
I think this is what I could... Okay. So as if you ask me, I do not know how come... playing sitar as part of the HSS course, I do not know. Because creative practice mein toh phir, if somebody wants to learn sitar, in BHU we have a facility of doing basically a diploma. A diploma can be done in the evening, diploma classes are held, and many students I know of, they go to learn German, French, or they do some diploma classes. Now they are having as part of creative practices playing sitar. So, because I don't know, I will not comment on the merit or the demerit of the case until I know the full case. So, all you can see is that you can develop a good ear for sitar, ki kiska taan achhi bag rahi hai, kiski buri bag rahi hai. So, you can hone up your skills of having a fine ear. That is one thing you can do. You can start learning sitar. Sometimes you have to start learning also. You have to learn the life. In our society, we are all mature people. Sometimes you have to learn to lie. No, it is not natural, but due to certain historical reasons, we have to learn to lie. So that way you can learn to love sitar. And the other thing is, as far as extra time goes, I think rather than taking it as a personal issue, you can discuss it with the head of the department. I mean, if you feel that this is taxing you too much and you are spending unproductive time. See, if I have been told to work for 8 hours and if I am doing 11 hours of productive work, I should not complain because 8 hours is a minimum work. It is not that it is maximum work. So if I am supposed to teach a minimum of 1 course and if I teach 2 courses, I shouldn't complain because 1 is a minimum. But if it is unproductive and unnecessarily you have to just sit and spend and waste time, and that is not being used in a productive way, I think you can request your head of the department that, sir, this is a problem. So can you find a way out? I think that is the only thing that I can tell. Professor Mena, if you have some other, because you have more experience of handling such situations, so if you have some more suggestion, you could answer.
सर एक चीज मैं क्लियर कर दूं कि ये मतलब जो भी क्रिएटिव प्रैक्टिसेस के लिए टीचर आते हैं बीएचयू से एक दिन के लिए और अगले दिन उसका प्रैक्टिकल प्रैक्टिस उनको करना होता है इसके लिए टीचर्स को असाइन किया गया है वहां पे जाने के लिए बट कभी कभी क्या है टीचर्स आउट ऑफ स्टेशन होते हैं या बिजी होते हैं तब हमें जाना पड़ता है उस सिचुएशन में आ रही है
Actually, sir, he has been very mild. He has said that जब वो कभी busy होते हैं, कहीं बाहर जाना होता है, वो actually हर हफ्ते ही उनको या तो busy रहते होंगे या उनको बाहर जाना पड़ता होगा. He could not say it. He has been very mild and polished in saying it. So I think, see, there are certain things about which I cannot comment because. Even if I comment, it doesn't have any meaning. Who am I to tell? I think you can talk in a positive way to the head of the department, ki sir, your problem hai.
Is it faced by all the students?
Yes.
All. Then you should talk to the head.
They are faculty advisors also. They are head of the department also. You can tell them that, sir, we want to work more. But give us some productive work. So you are giving us 3 hours of work, we are ready to work for 4 hours, but give us some productive work where we can learn something.
This point is very important.
Please.
See, you should not insist on number of hours only.
What you should worry about is whether it is productive. That is, you must also learn something out of that. If a sitar is played and you don't understand anything about sitar and you just sit there is nothing is served for anybody. So that's what you can plead with the head and convince him that it is not useful.
Yes, anything else? Any other question? Yes.
PADTs will be counted as teaching experience or not?
No, formally there is no provision to the best of my knowledge where PADTs are counted as teaching experience. They are not. I'll tell you. In some foreign universities and maybe some in India, I don't know, they have what is called certified TAs. So just as you have benchmark like ISO 9001 or something, there are certain foreign universities which have they offer courses which are TA certified. So once you do that course, you have to pass some exams. There are certain schedules that have to be followed, some questions to be answered. Once you do that, you become a certified TA. Right now, TLC is not offering that certification. In future, perhaps we may be able to follow. So once you do that, you become a certified TA. And through that certification, if you apply for some scholarship in some maybe some Indian universities and definitely in some foreign universities, you are given preference because in enrollment as well as in scholarship because they know that you are a certified TA and if your duties are used as a TA, they have a certain degree of surety that you will be able to perform. So we have certified TA courses going in many parts of the world where you become a certified TA. But here, as things stand today, it is just part of a training process, or you can say in lieu of the stipend that you get or training that you are supposed to do your TA duty, it is not counted as formal teaching experience, but informally, definitely, it is a teaching experience, it is a learning experience. See, please don't do that level of clapping. You know we are very happy with our lectures.
Even when people are appointed as on a temporary teaching position, even that is not counted. So there is no question of counting this TA experience.
Any other question? So with that, the refreshments will meet you after 4 p.m.
Sir, question is ये कि जो लोग sponsored candidates हैं या DSP sponsored हैं या फिर national कोई भी UGC कोई भी scholarship लेके आ रहे हैं यानी institute भरे से वो नहीं ले रहे हैं तो उनके लिए क्या कोई छूट मिल सकती है ऐसा कोई है आपके पास
institute rules. TNC doesn't have power to basically make those rules. These are government rules. So if the government rules says that people who are drawing stipend from external agencies and not the parent institution, if they are exempted from doing their TA duties, then that rule would apply to IITBHU. In case there is no such relaxation, even to those students, they would be supposed to perform their TA duties in the parent institution, even in spite of the fact that they are not getting stipend from that parent institution. माने कोई DST sponsored आया है कहीं कहीं से भी आया और अगर रूल में है कि उसको करनी है तो करनी पड़ेगी for that you need to check with the rules.
No, no, but even the DST and such CSIR and such organizations insist on some teaching load. So वहाँ से भी छूट नहीं मिले.
Okay, so thank you very much all of you, and once again thanks to Professor Lele who has been kind enough to spend so much time, and as far as my responsibility as chairperson TLC, I would like to thank Dr. Jindal and Dr. Amranjan Kumar, two faculty members who look after the basically TA orientation course, TA tutor orientation course. What appears to you to be a very simple exercise requires at least 1 week's one week of hard labor, where you have to go get the data, send information, make the logistical arrangements. So I thank both of my colleagues. It is because of their consistent and work because of which we are able to hold these TA classes. And I again thank you for your patience. You have outlived my expectations. Thank you.